I am Mr. True. In this video, I'm going to introduce two theorems to you and tie them together with one example that has two parts. Now, when we first started learning about the definition of area, we found the area bound by a function in an axis by estimating its area with a bunch of rectangles and developed that eventually into the definition of the definite integral and Riemann sums. Well, you saw that when we inscribed rectangles and used those as our partitions, that if we use inscribed rectangles, those areas of those rectangles underestimated the actual area bound by the function and the axis. And when we used circumscribed rectangles, we overestimated that. We call that the lower and the upper sums. Well, what we're going to talk about in the first theorem today is that there is a rectangle that will perfectly or exactly estimate or be equal to, the area of that rectangle will be equal to the actual area bound between the function and an axis on a closed interval. And we see that here in our third diagram. Again, the inscribed rectangle, I've drawn this lower value here as the minimum of our function just for convenience. It doesn't have to be on the right endpoint of our closed interval. But that inscribed rectangle is going to underestimate the actual area, and our circumscribed rectangle is going to overestimate it, where a lowercase m is the minimum value of our function on that closed interval, and capital M is going to be identifying the maximum value for what independent variable can you plug in and get that maximum value for the function, and that would be our circumscribed rectangle. Well, somewhere in that closed interval, there's guaranteed by the mean value theorem for integrals is a value c in that closed interval such that when you take the value of c and you plug it into the function, you get a height. And that height times width, the area of that rectangle is going to be equal to the, bound area that we discussed. So here we have the first theorem, the mean value theorem for integrals. If function f is continuous on a closed interval ab, then there exists a number c in the closed interval ab such that the definite integral of f of x dx on a closed or with a lower bound of a and an upper bound of b is equal to f of c times b minus a. Well, that c value that we plug in and get to and get a y value out of the function is going to be the height of our rectangle, and then b minus a is of course going to be the width along the x or could be y axis. Now this theorem just simply guarantees that there is a value of c such that that height times width, that area of that rectangle, is going to be equal to the area, again, bound by the function and an axis on a closed interval. Does not tell us where that value of c is. So we're not going to know from this theorem, and we won't know until we finish the second theorem, the height of that rectangle, if you, need that for your particular problem. The height of the rectangle, okay, this one here, this blue one, is going to be equal to the average value of the function AB. And that's going to be the next theorem that we take a look at. Once I state that theorem, I want to tie together again just the basic, where can you see within that theorem the basic area of a rectangle, which is simply length times width. And again, using the definite integral in the purpose of finding this area, area is equal to, again, length times width, and we are drawing that rectangle, and that's all there is to it. Let's get to the next theorem. Bam! Here we go. The average value of a function. If f is integrable on a closed interval of ab, then the average value of that function f on the interval is given by the definite integral from a to b of f of x dx, multiplied by 1 over b minus a. Now, this is how my textbook, gives you the average value of a function. That's the way it's written. But if I add a little bit to it here and say that this is going to be equal to, like I said in the previous screen, the height of the rectangle, then this is equal to f of c. So you can see all they did with our previous theorem is divide both sides by b minus a, and voila, you have the average value of a function. So what we're going to do is we're going to get this board erased. I'm going to put up a problem, and we are going to First, let's see here. What are we doing? We're going to first find the average value of a function and then use that average value, the height of that rectangle, to then go back and find what is that value of C that guarantees that F of C times B minus A does actually equal the value of the definite integral from A to B. Let's get to it. There we go. There's my remote. Find the average value of f of x equals negative x squared plus 8x minus 7 on the closed interval of 1 to 5. So whenever you're learning a brand new concept, it's a good idea, especially when it has a formula attached to it that you need to memorize, you know, to write that down as you do the problem and then fill in the spots, fill in the blanks, and then, you know, continue on with your problem. So again, the average value of a function is equal to 1 over b minus a times the definite integral of f of x dx from a to b. So when they give us our closed interval, the lower limit is a, or the lower value, and the upper value is b. So we have, this is going to be equal to 1 over 5 minus 1 times the definite integral. And again, this is a and b, so 1 to 5 of f of x. Now, of course, f of x is negative x squared plus 8x minus 7. And don't forget the dx, just for good notation. You know, what value are we integrating with respect to? So I'm going to pause the video and come back with the solution written up. If you want to try it on your own, you might want to stop it now and, you know, make sure that you remember how to do these definite integrals. We'll get the answer in just a second. Hope this is what you got. The average value or function on the closed interval of 1 to 5 came out to be 20 over 3. How did we get there? Well, we went again through the indefinite integration process. We used the power rule. We took this power of 2, increased it by 1, and divided by 3. I just pulled that negative 1 and the division of 3 out as a fraction, negative 1/3. Took that exponent of 1 and increased it by 1 and divided. So we had that 8 divided by 2. And then finally our negative 7x. And remember, we don't need to write the plus c that we get from indefinite integration, because as we go through the first fundamental theorem of calculus and find this definite integral, they're going to cancel out anyway. So clouds are coming through. Sorry about the white balance change there. And then we take the, remember this is a and b. So we take f of b and we subtract f of a along with that 1/4 now that's sitting out from. Out front from the 1 over b minus a, and basically just went through the simplification process, making sure to distribute that negative sign through the second group, through the f minus a part of our expression here, very long expression, and then common denominators, and then ultimately get 1/4 of 80 over 3. Now 80 over 3 is our definite integral f of x dx, the value, so the area on that closed interval was 80 over 3. And then finish by multiplying it by 1/4 and getting that average value of 20 over 3. Let me adjust my white balance and get to the second part of this example. Now this question comes in. Now that we know what the average value is, let's find that value of C on that closed interval where F of C is equal to B minus A. I'm writing this exactly how it appears in our book, which will take me an extra step, because remember, if we take this equation and divide both sides by b minus a, we're going to have f of x. We're going to have that f of c, the height of that rectangle, is the average value. So I'm going to plug in the numbers just how it looks here, but that's going to actually add a one step to my work that you might catch on to. Remember, bring this over and we have the average value. So at any rate, the value, the definite integral f of x dx from a to b, or that area on that closed interval, was 80 over 3. F of c is, let's see here. We don't know what c is, right? So we're just going to basically, you know, f of c, we're going to look at our function and just write in c everywhere there's an x. So we're going to have negative c squared plus 8c minus 7 times B minus A. Well, B minus A, B was 5, A was 1, so that would be 4. I'm going to write the 5 minus 1 just to show all my work, but it's 4. When we divide both sides by 4, we're going to have 80 over 12 is equal to negative C squared plus 8C minus 7, and we know that the 80 over 12, as we have already reduced, is equal to 20 over 3. Okay, well, we're getting into a situation where we have a quadratic and we need to, you know, solve for that. So I'm going to go ahead and multiply everything by 3 and get 20 equals negative 3c squared plus 24c minus 3 times 7 is 21. We're going to subtract this 20 over to the right-hand side of the equation and get, well, actually, for convenience sake, let's move everything to the left so that my leading term is positive. So we have, let's bring this over, and we have 3c squared, bring the 24c over, and we have negative 24c, and let's see, if we add 21 to both sides, we get positive 41, and let me just check my notes to make sure this is good. Okay. Now at this point, we have a quadratic, okay? That means that there might be not only just one value of c on that closed interval, there might be two, and that's possible. Could be more now, I guess, if the question's really complicated. So when we find that c on the closed interval, it may not be a unique solution. There might be two or more. So what we have now is a quadratic that we might solve by completing the square. We might try and factor it, but if we do 3 times 41 and look at that product, there's no factors of that that add up to be negative 24. In other words, this is not a factorable quadratic. So what we're going to do is, well, plug into the quadratic formula. We have C is equal to negative B, so negative, or the opposite of B, so the opposite of negative 24 plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4AC. So 3 times 41 all over 2a. And when you finish solving this, right off the top of my head, we get, oh, I had everything on, okay. Just checking the signs of my answers. What we end up with is C is equal to 2.472 and 5.528. So when we go ahead and solve that quadratic with the quadratic formula, we do get two answers. So there is possibly two places, two values of C where this equation is true, where the definite integral is equal to f of C times b minus a. But our definite integral, our closed interval, what the question was concerned with was the closed interval between 1 and 5. So, while it is possible to get two answers or, you know, more than one answer, more than one value of C on that closed interval, my second value of 5.53 basically is not within the closed interval that was asked for in the original problem. So, we did get a unique solution. That is the end of my video. So, you know what that means? Time for you to go do your homework.